there's no one right way to do silvopasture. There are wrong ways. So this session in the afternoon, we're going to be discussing and focusing on some of the real impacts that we're seeing with silvopasture in practice. So we're moving in a space where academic and anecdotal and experiential knowledge all really want to play together, and we all have to kind of come together and compare notes. And so that's really what we're going to be focusing on this afternoon in our session here. Bringing you all here today, I want to talk a little bit about what you're seeing as far as silvopasture success and struggles and challenges. So, you know, when I talk to my students, and maybe this isn't the right way to frame it, but I usually say there's no one right way to do silvopasture. There are wrong ways to do silvopasture. So with that sort of tidbit, I want to hear from each of you in turn kind of your thoughts on this idea of what are you seeing as some of the uniting factors of silvopasture success? What does that look like? And some of the common challenges that you feel like we're running into.
John, take us away. Oh, I was hoping that was yours.
I think I really appreciate both my peers here in the experience that they've had from an academic setting. I mean, I'm not out there planting trees. And I was like, wow, that's easy enough. You know, you just go stick some trees in the ground. And, you know, I've done some of that with high levels of success and very high levels of failure. I think you're right on target, that having that kind of business community that can address those issues, that can reduce the resistance for producers to get started, will help move this system much faster. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got to do stuff like that because from my perspective, as we move to scale, the people that are going to scale, they're going down to the local seed and feed store, and they're buying bulk, and you know, they've got people down there that can help them. And you say, well, plant a few trees, and they go, well, they got nothing. And they need that kind of, that's kind of the mentality that they work with, or the framework that they work within for their operations, and they need some of that. Mm-hmm. You know, Reggie may not agree with that, and I respect where Reggie's coming from if he does disagree. I mean, I just think that's where limitations are, and that can be met. Now, how profitable those business models are, you'll have to ask Austin what he's paying in taxes each year or whatever. But that's to me, I think that's you know, I suggested that maybe you plant walnut and black locust trees together. And I've suggested that. I had a farmer that did that. And the black locusts have done fantastic, and the walnuts they've kind of suffered. All right, but walnuts are well suited to our region. Mm-hmm. How do we get around those limitations? Anyway, I'm taking too much time. Go.
Okay. So I have a motto that I use, which is start small, but start now. I think that's the best thing for people to do, is that we want to keep our failures small. We want to keep our expenses small when we're just starting out with this stuff. If I were to talk to Molly, who was presenting earlier, I would say, let's try this again, but let's try with a very, very, very small planting. Let's plant like 10 trees, especially like for her instance, it's a very different climate. Like it's a Mediterranean climate. There's going to be more challenges if you're bringing a model from one system, one climate into a very different climate. So let's start with a very, very small planting and see what works, see what doesn't, then make adjustments for your next planting. The way that we've gone about it is when we work with a client, let's say they want to do 100 acres, we are not going to plant all 100 acres at once. Because even if we know how to get trees established, every farm is unique and every farm takes time and every farmer takes time to figure out what actually works for me, what actually works for my system. And what you think in year one, it might be different by year two, three, or 10. So what we do is we say, let's start with 20 acres of those 100. Let's get those established. And then let's wait 2 years to do phase two, because that gives you some real time to reflect, see what's going well, what's not going well, and then make adjustments before you have to apply for funding and buy your tree stock and that kind of thing. And then let's slowly and steadily continue on adding more trees to our systems. And the nice thing is that right now we really don't have, there's not near as much support and resources available for silvopasture as there's going to be in the years to come. We're really on an upward trajectory. So there's going to be, if you can be patient, start now, start small, get your experience, then over time you're going to be able to have access to better tree stock, better genetics, better cost share, better professional resources and guidance in your area. And so it really pays to play the long game and slowly, steadily build up the silvopasture systems on your farm.
Sorry to interrupt. The one comment I would throw at you, and I like your strategy, but what those trees look like at year 10 and what they look like at year 20 could be very different. And that's why we need the long-term research too, to say, okay, this is kind of what we think the trajectory looks like, but unless we carry it out, we really don't know. And then like the compositional changes in the understory that we see and that sort of stuff. We started out with bigger honey locust trees, and then suddenly they're putting all their energy into pods and the walnuts are big. So those sorts of things I think will be helpful as well to inform producers.
I think we started by the fact that the trees, the chickens, the cows, the sheep, they are not the ones destroying the planet. It is us. So we start with people. The trees are an instrument. Chickens are an instrument. It's a strategy. So to me, it's critical that we understand those fundamentals of systems change. Because if not, you could end up with millions of acres planted in silvopasture to no end, because we'll still be exploiting people, abusing each other, and treating each other like animals, like we do right now, like the children working in JBA's processing facilities in Nebraska, for example, that we're finally caught up with that. Okay, so I would much rather have a large-scale system across the country of small farms organized regionally so that we can actually acquire people power. And if we do that, everything else happens. Everything we're talking about happens. Silvopasture, how we want to go about the land. But we first need ownership, control, and governing structures so that we can actually decide what goes on the land. Until we do that, all of this is not really feasible. It's only feasible in our little corners. But let's stop calling a farm a system to start with, because it creates the wrong framework in the mind. And the mind, remember, three stages by which systems and everything materialized. You first think about it, or somebody thinks about it, or a whole population thinks about it, or a king, or a president, or a wannabe dictator thinks about it. Second stage is you express it and articulate it in a way that can be turned into engineering blueprints. And third, it gets built. What we're doing is articulating it, taking this big system, but systems, let's understand them, these are not farms. These are systems incorporate such a massive amount of infrastructure. And then within that is the production on the farm level. And that could be called the production model or something. And we could have hundreds of production models. That doesn't make a system until we aggregate all the infrastructure. And for us, the future of silvopasture, agroforestry, and all these other non-conventional, non-extractive, non-colonizing frameworks stand a bright future if we get a lot of people involved and we retake ownership control and governance and establish the governing structures so that we can start managing our regions as territories that belong to us, not to corporations and the government. Because when you get people involved, people vote, people speak, people mobilize, and people once we decide on the land, then we get a leg up. Until we can do that, again, the trees are not the ones that are destroying the planet, or the sheep, or the cows, or the chickens. And it is the people problem we got to fix first. And as we do that, then people start coming along. The more people you see in a gathering like this, the more people want to come to this. And that's the key to the success here.
I really appreciate that sentiment. And I'm glad you kind of started that thought process of people, that the concept of our role in this space and managing silvopastures and implementing silvopastures. So I think I got some, if you want to add to it, but I'm going to pose the next question then of the people problem, so to speak. What do you think is our biggest challenge, our biggest roadblock from that people power perspective? I think, Rahi, you did a great job kind of talking about governance and all of the issues tied with that of justice and sovereignty and that sort of thing. Do you have any additional thoughts? And Austin and John, I'd love to hear, what is our biggest roadblock as people in this equation?
Well, it's no different than the problem of the worms and the crickets and every other species. We are all born indigenous to the planet, made out of primarily carbon, right? Hydrogen, oxygen, 97.5% of us is made out of those core elements and the molecules that they form, primarily glucose, right? Okay, based on that, we're born both native to certain territories and indigenous to the planet itself. When we understand that, then we see the full potential of everything around us. When we embrace that innate intelligence and we cultivate the indigenous intellect that allows us that opening of the mind and the real potential of our minds. And with that, we can solve almost anything in front of us because we won't do it for the purpose of me and us and the colonizers and the companies and the profit and all of that. By the way, in the real solutions, there is no such a thing as a profit. And if you are paying taxes, you are actually not viable because that means you're extracting from the community and that's why you have to pay taxes. So it makes you an extractive industry. When you create wealth instead and management systems through governance and ownership and community basis, then you don't have to have a profit to have a super, super healthy livelihood. That's what we're talking about on the non-colonized side. Unfortunately, we're also born colonizers, no different than the crickets and the grasshoppers. They also want to survive and they go and take all the food and they want the food from the neighbor and the land from the neighbor and everything. And just like us, they do the same thing. And that is not the people problem, it's an organism problem. We're born both. The issue is, as we speak and as our words express what we are thinking, we always slip towards colonizing language. And when you think that way and express it that way, you will build it that way. That is the problem. But it is not a people problem. It is that we as people have actually embraced the colonizer and trashed the indigenous, ridiculed it, killed them, killed the indigenous. And we are always consistently trying to kill it within us. The second we start enhancing it and letting it flourish, we have solved not the people problem, but our issue as organisms of the planet, indigenous of the planet, who have chosen to be colonizers instead of just simply being part of this planet's living.
Austin, do you have any thoughts?
Well, I'll go back to what I was sharing about earlier in the need for service providers to make this simple and accessible to farmers, right? Because so many farmers have so much to do and don't have the opportunity, the time, the money to do this themselves. Think about how many people would have solar panels on their roofs if they had to buy the solar panels, if they had to install them up there, if they had to wire the electric. Like 1% maybe of the total people that have solar panels on their roofs right now would have it if there weren't businesses and services out there that made it easy for people to do that. And the same applies to agroforestry. Thankfully, agroforestry is a little bit easier, but the same thing applies. And what we've learned is we've tried to figure out how do we scale, how do we grow so that we can serve people that are coming to us and asking us to serve them and to create plans and do consulting and do implementation and installs all over the country. How do we serve the people in New York or Virginia or out in Missouri that want to do that? And what we're realizing is it really doesn't make sense. It really doesn't scale logistically very well. And so what we want to see is, and what we're actively working towards and training people, is we're training people to become service providers, agroforestry service providers for their region, to take the successes and the models that we've learned and developed and take them to their own region and apply them to their own context, so that there, this business, this service can be adapted to your personal context and what works for you, to your geographic context. Who are the landowners? What are their needs? What are the issues that they are facing, the problems that they're facing that can be addressed through agroforestry? And so we're actively working towards that and developing training so that we can have small, independent, regional service providers, whether that be a nonprofit or a business, that can serve the people in their area, and they get to know the people in their area. They know the resources that are available, and then they're able to serve people, whether they are large or small. Like right now, if I had a project in Missouri, sorry, Josh, I wouldn't be able to come to your farm. I'd have to be like a multi-thousand acre farm to come out and do any work, because the farther it is from us, the bigger the project has to be for us to justify it. But what we want to see is we want to see small service providers all over the place. Every single county should have someone that can offer services, that can walk a farmer through the process of establishing a silvopasture, and has the experience to be able to guide someone through that process. So that's what we're working towards.
John, from an academic standpoint, living in the realm of literature, what do you feel like our biggest people problem, the biggest hurdle that we have to overcome for successful silvopasture?
I want to expand on what these guys have said a little bit, because I'm not sure I can handle your question. PhD is a philosophy degree, and I spend more and more of my time kind of in philosophical musings. What does it mean to be human? What's the value of my life? How do I fulfill, you know, whatever it is I'm supposed to do in some sort of grander sense of purpose? Is there a purpose, right? You know, religious and philosophical questions that human beings have been asking for millennia. And the pace at which we need to be working on these questions, I think, is speeding up with the pace of technological change, because our technological change is happening a lot faster than our heart has changed, in my mind. So, you know, it's kind of very interesting, stepping back a little bit and trying to get back into the agroforestry framework. Reginaldo is talking in terms of sort of an indigenous system, and pardon my lack of eloquence with, you know, descriptions of it. Austin is talking about trying to get back to kind of smaller scale, spread, diverse systems. You know, both of these kind of look like a sort of the Jeffersonian model, right? Well, we'll have small farmsteads across the country and it'll all be grand. Okay, I spend a lot of time thinking about, well, that sounds good, but what about our policy? And policy is largely been driven. I remember a politician saying this years ago, said our policy is driven towards cheap food and cheap fuel. And to me, we live in kind of a world of bread and circuses. You know, as long as I'm happy and I'm entertained, you know, maybe we won't worry about climate change until it's just too dadgum hot to play football anymore. So you know, if we're stuck in that paradigm, it's got to be cheap. And I think of it, I think it's Michael Pollan that says, pay your grocer now or pay your doctor later. And so I think for me, the biggest challenge is culture, whether it's culture of the people that are out on the farm or the culture of the people that are in a metropolitan area and they want to be able to have lots of goodies at low prices and that sort of thing. Is that fulfilling? Is consumption and having more and more and more, you know, okay, I can move into Missouri and build a big farm. Well, okay, you know, I can push the natives out and we'll go into Oklahoma or wherever it is. I mean, yeah, the kind of the colonization mentality. You know, we had a whole idea of manifest destiny. This is what we're supposed to do. And so I guess, again, I'm sorry for all the navel gazing, but I'm back to this issue of what does it mean? And what should our values be? And how do I interact with you if you and I have very different values, right? But if we can find a common purpose, we think this will be healthier for your livestock, then, hey, I'm all about it. Let's work on finding a common purpose. I think in the context of the political moment in this country, we spend a lot of time saying, you're over there, and I'm over here, and we'll never be together again. And I think that's unfortunate and wrong, and we need to find where we can come to agreement on things. So I say, hey, would you like to put trees in your pasture? You say, well, what kind of crapola is that? I say, well, hey, do your livestock need shade? Yeah, okay, well, then that's, so how do we find places to bridge gaps in relationships, to provide the leadership? In my, from my perspective, it comes back to these relationships. And that's really what he's talking about and what he's talking about. Build relationships to help people do better jobs of managing their landscape.
So I love that thought, and we are running close to time. So I briefly want to wrap up with sort of a positive shift in direction, given all of this, right? We have a lot of different people to meet at different places, right? We got to meet people where they're at. And I think we still have a long way to go, but for each of you, what are you most optimistic about in this realm of silvopasture?
Well, I'll start. I'm optimistic because in less than 4 years, we went from having done all the research to actually starting implementation. And 10 years ago, I said, we need to shoot for 5% of the total poultry market. That means 3.5 million acres under this kind of system, 1 million farm operations, businesses with at least 6 related employments. That's 7 million people involved, 10 regions across the country, $7.5 billion of market share, and a tipping point that would allow us to flip over into other space. And yes, probably we're just scratching the bottom of that, but we are at the bottom, not below. And we were below, and we, for the most part, everywhere you go in the industry, we're still below, right? We're no longer there. And once you got started, again, what's the most important thing in this stuff? Get started. And we did, and we're doing well. And with more regions like this and more insurgents like you, getting that fire in your gut and going and saying no more with this, you know, fake stuff that we are sold in the name of progress and feeding the world, while also implementing a massive capacity to destroy the planet, the very foundation on which we depend to feed the world, right? And yet we destroy it in the name of feeding the world. Once we say no to that, this starts to gain that momentum inside of us, and then our thought process changes, what we say changes, and as a result, what we do changes. And as we see that happening in our sector with poultry in the middle, but then bringing in over 14 enterprise sectors that now intersect with trees, with pork producers, with all the other sectors, I just feel like we're at the beginning of an actual revolution, a revolution that is not just about, you know, going out there and talking, but actually establishing infrastructure that we can protect, defend, and expand collectively. So we are not just erased by another farm bill or by another company that buys us out.
I say I'm very optimistic about the future of silvopasture. So in the last almost 4 years, we have determined ways to simply and cost effectively get trees established in actively grazed pastures. We have methods to do that. We have made significant improvements on the nursery stock that we have available. Being able to bring the propagation methods, bring new propagation methods or return old propagation methods to bring this to the market at scale and at lower prices. We've made significant strides on the nursery side, and we're getting really good feedback and really good participation by more people as we have figured out a model that more people are adopting this for their own regions and starting to provide services for their own regions. And that's really what gets me the most excited, is seeing this spread and seeing a whole bunch of other people who are just very sharp and very motivated and have energy and are bringing this into their own regions and supporting farmers in their local communities. So, and we're only just a couple years in, and there's a lot that's happened in just a few years. And I'm really looking forward to, as more people get in this and more energy and enthusiasm comes into this, we're going to get a lot of creative minds working on climate change, working on agroforestry, and bringing their youth and creativity and variety of experiences to the table to be able to make new solutions and bring the solutions and the models that have been developed in one place and being able to adopt them in a whole lot more regions all throughout the country. And so I see that there's really bright future ahead for silvopasture and agroforestry.
So I'm excited because of people like in Austin, people who have started doing all the stuff that he said. I don't speak very eloquently. I think Austin did a very nice job of talking about that. We are at the point of probably the largest intergenerational land transfer, at least in Virginia and probably across the country. The number of the people that I deal with are interested in something different. Whether or not they're willing to go the distance on these systems kind of is still an open question. But successes that people such as and Reggie are showing provides a model or blueprint for those changes or for those people who are going to inherit farms. I have a lot of kind of cautionary feelings about all of that. And I'm a little older than he is, so maybe that's part of the change or the differential in optimism. But again, seeing people address problems, develop solutions, bring creativity to it, the growth of all of these private enterprises that are in the space now that weren't there 20 years ago when people looked at me like, what? and you know, it's very rewarding to see those changes. And so that is exciting and encouraging.
I would like to say that we are here at an academic institution. We have four scientists
now tracking and documenting what we're doing with poultry and the landscape. And from an academic perspective, we have now finally gotten into this space where we are codifying ancestral indigenous knowledge into teachable forms. We have the first online poultry, regenerative poultry platform with 14 different chapters. Regenpoultry.com, if you want to go there and check it out. Regenpoultry.com. All that needs is a few validations
to be able to be turned into a new curriculum across the country, as long as the institutions are willing to come on board. And we have seen that happening, ISU, MU, Vermont, I mean, all over the place, right? So I see also a bright future for the academic institutions to progress, to move into this new space, and to help in the process of further codifying this so that the new generations is not fed fake stuff anymore, but the real things, the real solutions.
All right, an excellent ending thought. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you to our guests, John, Austin, and Reggie, for your excellent, insightful thoughts.